Everybody, welcome to C.R.E.A.M. episode number 19. Hope you guys love it. Great information. Come in, watch C.R.E.A.M. episode number 19.
So, Jason, you recently were in Washington, D.C., our nation's capital, for a pretty esteemed conference. Tell us about that.
Yeah, Norm, I went to the African-American Financial Professional Conference. It was held by American College. It was a really good conference. It was the first time I actually made it in person. I did the 2020 virtual one due to COVID. But this year, I made sure I made some time and made it out. It was a really good event. Met some really good financial professionals, reconnected with some good friends that I know in the industry. You had 1,000 African-American financial professionals where you just learn best ideas, topics, and learn a lot about how to work with women better, nonverbal communication, how to impact and do a better job in my community about financial advising. It was a really, really good conference. I think every African-American financial professional should be there. I just got so many good golden nuggets being there. I'm going to make sure I put down my calendar every single year now, from now until the day I retire, which I don't plan on doing. So,
which is never, because you love what you do and you're passionate about it. And I know you'll always be teaching and writing books and helping people with their finances. That sounds like an awesome conference. And you even told me before we got on the podcast that you had the opportunity, they asked you to speak, and they did a big, you did a big speech and a video segment for them, right?
Yeah. So, which was real cool. So American College asked me to do the interview with me about why I went to the conference and what I got out of it. And I told them one of the big things I got was, I go to all these other conferences, Million Dollar Roundtable, NAFIN meetings, which are great meetings. But I love about the African-American Financial Professionals Conference is that you go to this meeting and there's certain issues that are only in the African-American community. And with that conference, it touches those things, which is really good if I could make sure I could bring those back to the African-American community and my community and just, you know, just help our clients even better. I love those other conferences, but when you go there, you see 1,000 people who are doing the exact same thing that you do, and you share different ideas. You know, you're not on an island by yourself, and you actually say, hey, I go through this issue. And the person's like, you know what? I go through these same issues, and this is how you combat it. It's a great conference. I think everybody, if you're African-American in the financial professionals, or you think about becoming a financial professional, you should definitely go to this conference. It's great. I want to say thank you to American College to do it. Yeah, it's awesome, man.
And American College is a hell of a university or college as well. And DC is incredible for history, culture. But that sounds like a fantastic gathering. And yeah, I could just imagine you probably talked to everyone and learned so much. And I can't wait to see that speech. And you make some important points about the prevalence of financial education and planning and advising among minority communities and the Black community. And there are some encouraging statistics where over the last two, I'm just going to paraphrase now because I don't have it in front of me, but I think it's over the last 2 or 3 years, African-Americans have started to invest, new investors, at a much higher rate than any ethnic group. So it's catching on, and people are really starting to educate themselves and starting to plan for their family's future financially. So keep up the good work.
Yeah, thanks, man. And I do see that a lot. I know during COVID, it seemed like more and more people trying to learn more about the stock market, equities, NFTs, crypto. And I think people want to understand how they can really build wealth for their families more than ever since I've been in the business. So I'm really excited about where that is headed towards and being involved with that movement.
That's wonderful. I even told you off mic that I wanted to hit that conference with you one day. That'd be fun.
Yeah, I think next year should be in the Midwest. Look out for it. Norm can come from the Philippines back over to the States just for the conference.
Wonderful, man. I'll be there. I'll meet you there.
All right, cool.
All right, Jason, we just talked about how you were in Washington, D.C. for a conference, and you had the golden opportunity to visit something that was really impactful for you, the African-American Museum, as part of the Smithsonian Museum in D.C. So tell us about that experience.
I'd say that was the most life-changing museum that probably I've been to, not probably, for sure I've been to my life. The museum is a six, seven floors. The first bottom half of it just goes through the history and the challenges of how slavery happened, and the life of a slave, and then going from there to Jim Crow. And then the second half of it is just about the culture of just Black culture, and which is really American culture. Let's get this right. Even though they say the African-American Museum, I think this is more of a museum of American history. I think American and Black history intertwine so much where it's actually American history. And for me, it was life-changing to see the challenges that African-Americans face in this country and how they overcame them. And I truly believe every child who turns 18 should go to this conference. If you're 18, somebody should pay and fly for them just to go to this museum. I think it's that life-changing and impactful to understand the struggles that people went through and how they overcame it and became better individuals and people because of it. I think it's...
That must have been incredibly powerful and terrifying and emotional and uplifting at the same time. You probably came out of there just drained emotionally, right?
Yeah, so especially the bottom half, it's exhausting, I would say, and draining. But, you know, it then makes you question, makes me question, am I doing enough? When you see people or you see the lives of the people who went through there, who was not allowed to read, but who figured out how to read, who went through so many obstacles just to be free or to get an education and went through... or built their own town and bank or all these other so many challenges they went through, and they did it. You question yourself, I do while I was going through, like, am I really doing enough? And I need to get rid of any excuses I have about anything I can accomplish in life is an excuse, because these people accomplish way more than I can even comprehend or I can even dream of. It's crazy.
At the risk of their lives and their families' lives. And, you know, like you said, just to read was a revolutionary act. You know,
it's not just revolutionary. It's like they were saying how it was a crime for those people to read.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, of course.
And, you know, where it was a crime of death for someone to read, which was crazy.
Man. Yeah. So that's I definitely want to visit the African-American Museum at the Smithsonian as well. I know that's you said it best. It's not part of our culture. It is our culture. It's America. And so that's important for everyone to go see. So, yeah, thank you for sharing that, Jason.
Yeah, no problem, man.
All right, Jason, we talked about your time in Washington, D.C. and your visit to the African-American Museum at the Smithsonian. And I actually have a book recommendation for you if you haven't read this one yet. I recently got back into reading. I warmed up the Kindle and I read His Truth is Marching On, John Lewis and the Power of Hope, by John Meacham. And Meacham does a good job with sort of the historical biographies. But John Lewis, of course, growing up poor in the Jim Crow South and became one of the top civil rights advocates and proponents of nonviolent protest in the world. And he was, it's interesting, with civil rights, a lot of times we just play into narratives now. So civil rights, you know, most people go, oh, Martin Luther King. And yes, that's true. But John Lewis has done as much, if not way more, than Martin Luther King, in part because he had a long career. He wasn't assassinated, right? But he was younger, but he was a contemporary with Martin Luther King, a contemporary with Malcolm X. And all of these movements were coinciding at the same time. And a lot of times they had conflict between them. You know, Malcolm X with, stand up for yourself and use by any means necessary, and was actually segregationist, versus, you know, Martin Luther King and John Lewis were. So there was politics and internal bickering, even within these organizations of nonviolence. But his book is so inspiring for civil rights advocacy and showing the struggle to achieve what he calls the beloved community in America. And, you know, where it's failed, but where it's also where we have made incredible strides and come a long way. So for anyone who really wants a deeper look at civil rights, the civil rights movement, Jim Crow, I mean, the things I read in there, my God, just, you know, insanity, inhumane, obviously. But anyone who wants some inspiration and a historical perspective, I recommend His Truth is Marching On, John Lewis and the Power of Hope.
good recommendation. I do appreciate it. I know there was so many different people who were during that whole civil rights movement, Black Power, and there was so many different issues with it. That's another good book I need to read. I know Martin Luther King's story that well, but I don't know John Lewis' story and background as much as I should.
Yeah. And I, like I said, I learned so much, you know, that narrative, you know, Martin Luther King, I had a dream speech, you know, that's what a lot of people know about Black empowerment and civil rights and overcoming Jim Crow and stuff. But you just get an incredible view and how much of it really was politics as well. There was, you know, there was a lot of politicians, sheriffs, you know, local mayors who weren't necessarily segregationist, even in the South, but adopted that just to get elected. And they realized they could, you know, sounds familiar, right? With someone we know who was maybe just the president who his home was raided in Mar-a-Lago and hopefully he goes to jail. But people who just picked that up and started parroting those messages just because they know it would get them elected and the power that those constituents brought. But in general, yeah, the book was incredible. I learned a ton. So highly recommend it. And if you have more from me, I know you're a voracious reader. Please send them my way now.
Oh, will do. Will do. I'm adding that book as you speak onto my Amazon book list.
There you go. Jason, now we're recording this mid-August, and it'll probably be out on the airwaves in about a week or so. And in August, in California at least, it's the time for back to school. It's back to school season. So I know you're the proud father of some children, and you probably wanted to share a couple thoughts or feelings about back to school time every year.
I wanted to say back to school for all the kids. I hope you guys enjoyed the new school year. And what is crazy to me is, and I've had this conversation, I talk about this all the time lately, is I remember back in the day when I went to school, summer break was actually summer break. It was Labor Day to Memorial Day. Memorial Day to Labor Day. Now that is no such thing. So, kids, for having a shorter summer and not have as good of a summer as I did as a kid. So hope you guys had a great school.
I'm going to jump in on that because, you know, you're absolutely right. Like, I remember going back early September, I think it was. It wasn't even August. But, you know, on the East Coast, we have to add snow days to the end of every school year. So let's say we were supposed to get out June 18th. I don't know. I'm just pulling that out of my ear. But if we had 6 snow days that year, we'd have to extend another 6 days to make it up. And those were absolutely useless days. The teachers didn't have any more lesson plans. There was no tests. It was just busy work. It was hot because we don't have air con in East Coast schools. And everyone just sat there and, you know, tried not to kill each other, fighting in the cafeteria or something like that. So it was pretty crazy, man. But yeah, it's back to school in California now. How about these days? How is it different with, I know back in the day, it was a big deal to go school shopping and get your new fits and your new sneakers and stuff. Is it still like that?
Oh yeah. My son, my oldest Kai, was going crazy going online, seeing what he could get. And nowadays the average cost for school supplies has drastically went up. So back in 2019, the average school cost was $167. Now the average American is spending $864 on school costs. So that's including new shoes and everything else. All these kids want these $200 pair of shoes. And I remember my mother growing up would not let me get any pairs of shoes over $100. So I was lucky, fortunate to never had a pair of Jordans growing up.
Even $100, like, you know, you're a young man, you're only 21, but, you know, when you grew up and you were a little kid, $100 was actually maybe not Jordans, which were probably 120 or something, but that was a lot of money for a pair of shoes back then. You know, I think I was on the $50 shoe plan. You know, I had some Velcro on mine, you know.
and now it's crazy. His shoes are now collectibles. People want the hottest shoes. And then now people want custom shoes, this whole shoe.
For $800-something per, I wonder if that's per household. It can't be per kid, but I mean, that's probably just average per household. But that's an insane amount of money to spend on the back to school every year, huh?
It's the outfits, man. Those clothes are, you know, kids know how to persuade their parents on getting better quality stuff. And they're just spoiled, man.
Well, so hopefully they're learning a lot. Hopefully it pays off, huh?
Yep. Hopefully it pays off. Everybody, it is NFL season coming up. This is about to be a fun, exciting season coming up. As we see, a lot of teams made a lot of big changes over the offseason. We know the Niners got a new quarterback, Trey Lance. We're about to see if he's the truth or is he a draft bust. I'm really excited about what's happening in AFC, NFC. So here are my Super Bowl predictions.
Yeah, I want to hear this. Let me write this down, timestamp it, carve it in stone, because I want to hear who you see going to the Super Bowl.
Out of the NFC, this is crazy right now, Norm. I'm really thinking hard about this. But out of the NFC, I'm going to pick the LA Rams again. Mm. I think they're going to repeat. They got all the weapons. I think they're still deep. I'm going to pick the LA Rams. Coming out of the AFC, I'm going to pick the Buffalo Bills. So Bills versus Rams, Super Bowl. That's going to be the Super Bowl picks for this year.
I think that's a great, those are pretty good picks. The Rams, super talented, stacked on both sides of the ball. They paid their players, so they're happy. The only thing is, man, it is hard to repeat in the NFL. You know, it's a game of hunger and pain. And it's just so hard once you won that ring and a short offseason and you're celebrating and you're getting new contracts. And, you know, it's hard to repeat that. So they may get there, but I agree. Bills should be there. And I think actually Bills win the Super Bowl. How about you?
I agree with you on the Bills win the Super Bowl. But you know what? I'm about to go back a little bit on the NFC pick. I'm thinking about the logic. I'm actually going to go with this is tough. The Buccaneers. Okay. I'm going to go with Tom Brady in the Super Bowl versus the Bills, and the Bills win the whole thing.
Yeah, that would be you know, the old goat versus the young sort of up and coming quarterback. That'd be a fun Super Bowl. It'd probably be a lot of points too. Good football. So there you have it. We got Bucks and Bills in the Super Bowl, according to Jason. How about what are your predictions for the 49ers and then the Raiders? I know they're not, you know, they're not a local team anymore for you, but I know a lot of people still got love for the Raiders and Cali. So what do you think about 49ers and Raiders? What kind of seasons they'll have?
Vegas Raiders. I'm about to pull up their schedule, but I'm going to pick the Vegas Raiders. And I'm about to get a lot of hate from this. I think they're going to end up being in third place in the AFC West. I think they're going to be behind the Chiefs. They're going to be behind the Chargers, and they'll take third place for the West.
But they'll still have a winning record, you think?
8-8.
No, you are going to get, you just lost every subscriber who's a Raiders fan. Huh?
Oh, I apologize. I forgot, 17 game season now. So I would say 9-8. I would say they'll be 9-8.
Oh, there you go.
So and I might
hate,
make
the hate won't be as bad,
but I might just change my mind before then. Matter of fact, you're going to be fourth place in the West. Ooh. I forgot about Russell Wilson being in the Broncos. That puts them in the fourth place in the West.
Ooh. Hey, at least people in Vegas there watching them could have, you know, free shrimp buffets and go gamble a little and have some fun, huh?
Exactly. And the Raiders would go 7-10.
You mean the 49ers?
No, the Raiders are going to be 7-10. I switched that up, but they're going to be 7-10.
Oh, okay.
I'm thinking about it right now.
Okay, so Raiders are going to be fourth place and then 7-10. Gotcha.
Correct. Oof. While the Niners will be third place in the West. So the first place in the West is going to be the Rams. Second place is going to be Cardinals. Third place is going to be Niners. And then last place, unfortunately, is going to be the Seattle Seahawks.
Mm. And what do you think the record, record will the 49ers have?
They're going to have the same record as the Raiders, 7-10.
It's going to be a miserable season in the Bay Area if they go 7-10.
The men in butterscotch and pink is going to be miserable.
And how about their quarterback? How do you think he'll do?
He will struggle this year. He won't be that good. He will struggle. I know a lot of Niners fans are excited. He had a fantastic game last night for the first drive, but it's the preseason. Don't get too excited. Nobody plays hard during the preseason besides the guys who try to make the team.
And no one game plans. You know, the opposing coaches don't really care. They're just trying to, you know, get their team to learn the playbook and run the plays. And they're focused on their own system and their own players. But during the season, when you have a week to game plan against the weaknesses of the other QB and the other team, it's a whole different ball game, huh?
Whole different ball game. And you know what's the funny? I'm looking at the Niners and Raiders play each other January 1st in LA. I mean, not LA, but in Vegas. That's going to be the best New Year's ever in Vegas.
That's going to be Niners versus
Raiders. That's going to be hectic.
Man, there's going to be a lot of there's going to be a lot of brawls down there, huh?
I doubt it because I don't think people won't be able to get up to the game because they're going to be partying so much because it's New Year's.
So you think there's going to be empty seats because people are too hungover to make it to the game, huh?
Exactly.
Oh, my God. That's hilarious. Well, NFL season, I know that's. It's welcome for everyone, and it's so much fun. It's such a big part of America and our fabric of our entertainment. And so NFL season starting off, and we have Jason Matthews' picks. So from his lips to God's ears.
They're about to come true. Once again, thank you all for listening to the full episode of C.R.E.A.M, episode number 19. If you love this podcast, please share it on your YouTube, Facebook, Google, Apple, or anywhere else that you listen to the C.R.E.A.M podcast.